Well, thanks to the organizers for having me. I'm going to try fairly ambitiously to talk about three closely related studies that have all happened in Lahore and are sort of part of this hive of activity in GovTech. We've benefited from a tremendous number of collaborators in implementing these projects, including a long list of co-authors who are way too long to put on the slide. Okay, so before I jump into each of the studies, kind of working in this space, I want to point out sort of three observations that have, you know, come out of doing this work that I think tie everything together. The first, and I think this was kind of apparent in the last presentation and also in Umar's remarks, there's a lot of space in government where it's just very hard for a government to know what's going on, especially kind of in very, you know, rigid hierarchical organizations. You don't really have sort of all of the data you need to know, are programs being implemented well, are doctors and teachers at school, are they teaching well, and so on. And I think this is sort of a very basic problem, but it's a problem where there's clearly space that technology can fill. So when we started the first project in this space, which was just kind of looking at doctor attendance in hospitals, 68.5% of doctors weren't there when you would go during sort of normal operating hours. And so that, to us, was kind of an indication that just these simple information bottlenecks are a place where there's kind of some place for technology to get leverage, where there's sort of, you know, room at the margins to make things better. The second observation I'd make is that as you start to work in these systems, you start to realize, you know, governments fundamentally are made of people, right? And they're people that are heterogeneous in their tastes and their psychology and in their preferences. And so, you know, for us, it's been a very fertile area to start to think about, well, how are they going to interact with this technology? What are their incentives? How are they going to embrace it? How are they going to react to it? And the final point I'd make is, as you sort of start to chip away at the first part, so you start to gather more information on what governments are doing, where teachers are attending school, and so on, you start to generate quite a bit of data, like the stuff that Umar was showing us, that tell us a whole lot about the behavior of agents in government. And so the project that I'm going to spend most of the time focusing on today is going to be asking, you know, can we take that seriously? Can we use the information that we're getting about how people are behaving in government and then use that as a basis for writing contracts with them, performance contracts with them that are individualized across people? So these are kind of three very general observations I'll start with. There are three projects. The first one, I'll just give a quick overview. It's essentially the health analog of the education project that Umar described. We were working with government inspectors whose primary job was to travel from around to different clinics and just see, you know, are medicines available, are doctors attending work or not. What we did was to say replace all of that with a simple smartphone app where the main innovation was that their inspections were geo-stamped and time-stamped, which provided a means of auditing whether or not they were actually doing their inspections. And the result was to cause them to increase the amount of inspections that they were doing. The good thing was that working directly with government, this was scaled and sort of implemented at a very large scale. So once we kind of realized we could get that part right, we could use smartphones as a means of observing whether or not people in government were doing what we were hoped that they were doing in the first case, inspecting hospitals, we wanted to start to ask, well, can we use this as a means of writing performance contracts? Now we have kind of much clearer information on what they're doing. Sort of the natural next step in our mind was to say, why don't we then provide incentives, you know, based on whether or not they're meeting their targets? And so we did this in the context of polio, and I'll describe that in quite a bit more detail in subsequent designs. And within this, there's sort of a hard part and an easy part. The easy part at this stage is to say, we observe your performance, now we want a contract on it. The hard part was to say, we want to now also kind of write an individualized contract based on some sort of principled measurement of who you are and how you act in government. And then the final project, which is really more a project in principle than a project in fact, is going to be to sort of, you know, Umar put up these maps showing you that the real question with polio vaccination is sort of the spatial coverage of vaccine. If you're going to eradicate a disease, you need to kind of get comprehensive spatial coverage. This is something that we're working on going forward, which is to just say, now we're at a stage where we definitely value vaccine more in some places than in other places, and so wouldn't it just be appropriate to then incentivize people accordingly to deliver vaccine where it's going to yield a high return? Hey, P4P is something that people have studied a lot in economics, including important work by Karthik. And in a lot of these, the Gordian knot is, you know, if you're going to incentivize people on something, you need to observe what they're doing. You need to have kind of a measurable target that they're meeting. In our case, we're going to work with these vaccinators who are going door to door. Just so we're all on the same page about polio, it's a disease. It's a disease that affects young children. It's a disease that we've known how to vaccinate against for a long time, and we've been very close at several points to being in sort of striking distance of eradicating the disease, which is obviously a massive global public good. It's something we all aspire to. It really only exists now in Pakistan and in Afghanistan, occasionally in Nigeria. And when we started this in 2014, things have gotten a lot better since then. But when we started this in 2014, there were 297 new cases in Pakistan, which is actually great cause for concern because many carriers are sort of asymptomatic. So 297 was enough to create quite a bit of worry in this space. This is what a polio vaccination looks like. This is just a poster in the Department of Health encouraging parents to get their children vaccinated. And these are the roving vaccination teams, so these are the actual people we're working with to write better incentives. They travel door to door. When they arrive at a door, they go knock on the door, ask, are there any children under five? If so, they ask them to come out to the courtyard, and they provide them those simple vaccine, just the drops. And then when they're done, and you know, prior to introducing any technology, this was the system for observing whether or not they'd done their job, they would leave these wall chalkings on the outside of the courtyard where they provide some basic information, what team they're in, how many children were vaccinated, what date they were there, and so on. And so the first stage in this project was just something quite simple, which was to say, we're going to give them smartphones, and rather than have them record this information on a wall and some government auditor go around and see if they collect that, just put this all on a smartphone, centralize it on a dashboard like we saw before. Okay. The reporting systems, I mean, they kind of basically have pretty bad incentives under the prior scheme. So you just self-report. You say, here are the number of vaccinations. So each one of these rows is a different vaccination team. In the second column, the numbers there are the numbers of vaccinations that they're reporting. They were always hitting their targets, which really didn't happen that much once we moved to digital collection. So clearly a lot of this was falsified. So the prior incentive scheme, just so you can have a sense of where I'm going, so before we got involved, the incentives they faced were they got a daily wage of 100 rupees independent of the number of vaccinations they performed. In practice, they often fell short of their targets, which is sort of broadly consistent with what we know about performance in this sector, and so we implemented these smartphones. The most important object in this smartphone, beyond the geo-stamping and the time-stamping, which lets us know where they went, and the information they're entering into the dashboard, which tells us what they did, is this object. And I think this, to my mind, really embodies a useful place where we're taking economics seriously in the design of these programs can be quite useful. So it's just a very simple object. It's a slider bar. And we're asking them, how many vaccinations would you like to do on Monday, and how many vaccinations would you like to do on Tuesday? If you slide it all the way to the left, it's I want to do all of my allocated vaccinations on Monday. If you slide it all the way to the right, I want to do them all on Tuesday. And there's a big field in economics, and this is a place where a lot of my collaborators really specialize, that thinks deeply about how do people make intertemporal exchanges? How do they make decisions about how much they want to work on Monday or how much they want to work on Tuesday? And it turns out that by making people make a series of these types of decisions, I can actually learn a lot about their stable tastes for how they allocate work over time. And I can use that as a means of kind of providing them incentives individually. So every individual is going to have some different kind of degree of tastes over intertemporal exchanges. And this is basically what we're going to use as a means of providing them a customized incentive. So there are really three parts. The first part is observing the work that they're doing. The second is introducing a pay-for-performance contract. And then the third is saying we want to individualize that pay-for-performance contract based on what we can measure about your preferences. So here is just an example of a map, which I think you know is a close analog to the ones that Umar showed, where now we're starting to realize one of the big problems is that there's lots of holes in coverage and space. And so we thought, you know, we succeeded in this second project in kind of moving vaccinations across time by providing differential incentives to different people. We thought, well, wouldn't the natural analog be, rather than varying incentives temporally, let's vary them spatially and achieve this problem of sort of solving the last mile problem to push vaccinations around in space rather than pushing them around in time. Okay, so quickly, the results of each of these studies. So the first one was a success in the sense that it did what it was supposed to do very basically. It increased the rate of inspections, which I think is sort of unsurprising because by having these people carry a smartphone, you've sharply increased their incentive to do their job. There's a tremendous amount of kind of monitoring tied to that. The pay-for-performance contracts just by themselves worked pretty well. So they increased kind of, there was an incremental increase of additional 16%, so vaccinations rose by that much. And then customizing incentives, individualizing them across people, this is kind of where, to our mind, there's sort of money on the table. You get an additional bump in meeting your policy target of 33%, and that's just kind of comes from writing different contracts, not even increasing your fiscal outlay or spending more money. Okay, so going forward, I guess I want to sort of leave these as food for thought, and sort of the lessons that I've learned working in this stuff. So collecting data and kind of people in government are generating a tremendous amount of data all the time, and there are new technology systems that are really allowing us to do a lot more here. But I think kind of beyond just using that as a means of diagnosing problems, I think where we can really make kind of serious inroads is to start to think about how can we turn this on its head and use it as a means of kind of actively designing things that allow us to do things that we couldn't previously. So I think of our example of either temporally tailored or spatially tailored incentives as being just one application where when I know a lot about a person because of decisions they've made or because of the data they're generating, then I can use that as a basis to start to think of, you know, how do I incentivize them appropriately to meet the service delivery targets we have in mind? Okay, so thanks.